Hi, and welcome back to Recovery His Way on the campus of His Way Recovery Center here in Huntsville, Alabama. I'm Stuart Whiting, sitting down once again with our director, Tom Reynolds. Hey, Tom.
Good afternoon.
Continuing again in our discussion on the 12 steps of AA, and we've covered the first 10. And I know last week we were looking at transitioning very much from these 9 steps, which get us to a point, and this 10th step is about in a constant state of maintenance,
right,
and recognizing whenever we see that we have a failure or a fault or anything we need to address, we admit it and we try to do that right then and really rework mm-hmm. the steps in that.
Right.
So where are we going now in the 11th step?
Well, I think the 11th step really takes us more deeply into this continued pursuit. It's kind of more of a maintenance thing in terms of my relationship with God, you know, seeking with prayer and meditation to maintain and deepen my constant contact with God. So it's really about continuing to develop and nurturing that relationship. So I think it's part of that. It's part of the ongoing maintenance thing. I mean, I think 11 and 12, both, it's kind of my relationship with God and then my relationship and outreach to other people in the mission that I'm on.
So in 10, when I recognize that this is going to be a constant ongoing part of my life,
right,
where, I mean, this is in a part of anyone's life, not just an
right,
addict.
Right,
so we're not,
right,
I'm trying
right.
to be thoughtful about who I am
right.
and about my relationships. And then as I do that, I'm drawn to God.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like here's a little bit of the transition.
Right, right,
not
right.
just an internal recognition, but where is it constantly bringing me back
right,
to?
Right, absolutely.
And so I want
right.
to restate that. Just I sought through prayer and meditation to improve my conscious contact with God, as I understand him, praying only for his will for me and the power to carry that out. So, let's just kind of walk through the different phrases of this. I know you have a lot to say about prayer and meditation. Maybe before we get to that, this jumps off the page at me, conscious contact with God.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think the motivation
well,
for
I think,
that is?
You know, I think the recognition that this is an intentional thing. You know, I'm intentionally pursuing this relationship. I mean, all of us can recognize we've been created by God. God's moving in our lives. A lot of people will talk about being spiritual people and
right.
that we have a sense of spiritualness and that I have a spirit and that I'm connected with some spiritual entity. But I think here it's an intentional pursuit. It's like I'm setting aside time. I'm making effort. I'm putting forth. It's like you're in a marriage. I'm in a marriage. And we have a constant contact with our spouse. However, there's times when they would prefer that we make some conscious effort to
right.
make that contact, right?
Right?
And so it's that type of, I think, intentionality that this is expressing.
Which immediately says there's going to be time commitment, there's going to be thought, which,
right.
of course, that prayer and meditation, which I still obviously want to come back to. And in that working that out, well, I guess let's talk about prayer and meditation here, because the rest of it is more about what we think we're seeking.
Right.
What is the biblical kinds of examples you use and the teaching you use to really ingrain this idea of how powerful and how meaningful and how important prayer and meditation is?
Right. Well, I think fundamentally, I mean, I guess I'll start with the meditation part. Which is the part we talk less about than
right.
any. When we hear meditation, we think of Eastern religion. We think of, you know, Hinduism and yoga and things like that, or kind of this meditative type of thing. And we don't typically think of it as a Christian type of value. However, Scripture is replete with that idea and emphasizes some of the core passages. I mean, in Psalm 1, you know, he says, "Blessed is the man who does not walk in the way of sinners, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on that law he meditates day
mm-hmm.
and night."
Mm-hmm.
The one thing I would emphasize in Christian meditation and in Jewish meditation and that old Judeo-Christian meditation is, unlike Eastern meditation, it tends to be about kind of emptying yourself and
right.
you know, not thinking about anything and having a blank space and all that kind of stuff. This is really a meditation throughout Scripture is about meditating on God's
mm-hmm.
Scripture. It's on meditate, and really, so meditation is about listening, right? It's
yeah.
about hearing God's message and dwelling on that message and reflecting on that message and really honing myself on that message. It's beyond even just reading the Bible. Certainly reading the Bible becomes the fodder that gives me the information, but then I continue to ruminate on that idea and I think about that idea and I reflect on those ideas. And there's all kinds of ways, obviously, we can meditate on it. We can memorize it. We can reflect on it. We can come up with songs that, you know, instill those ideas, all those things. But it's primarily about listening. And one of the things I really think is important, we tend to, I think, pass over the meditation part. We think about prayer because that's an active thing that I do. Mm-hmm. But I think the most important part of most of our communication that we fail so much at is we're not good listeners. We don't hear. Yeah. You know, we'll talk over each other. We'll, you know, make our point without really fully hearing the other person's point. I mean, I think our culture is, again, reflects that in everything you see.
Yeah, you see all these talking head shows, and it's five people up there that they have no intention of ever hearing what the other person's saying.
Right.
It's just, what? Let me get my message out there. And, oh, yeah, he said that, but, you know.
Yeah. And so this step is about, I think, primarily listening. And I think that's the critical thing that we spend too little time in our relationship with God. And even, you know, I think I'm not really prepared to say something to God until I've heard from God. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's important, this idea of listening, meditating, reflecting on his teaching becomes critical to this step.
Yeah, this is one thing that's been really near and dear to me in the last few years, is a little bit of an awakening to how to meditate on scripture differently. I think there's a sense in our, you know, heritage where I'm going to the Bible for instruction and for law and instruction. Certainly there, it's instructive, no doubt about it. But it's not primarily written to be a law book or an instruction manual. And I think when we only know to engage in the Bible on that level, one, we're not gonna wanna spend a lot of time there. And it's dry, and it's, you know, it doesn't feel connective. And when I read every passage and wonder, all right, what is this saying to me to do right now? Well, it may not be saying anything for you to do, but to recognize that, you know, over half the Bible is story. And we all read stories or consume stories and just spend time in it and meditate on, okay, what is, you know, what's going on here, and what's being valued, and what's, you know, what are the consequences coming from this? And so I think we've failed often in helping people know how to read the Bible, you know, and understand the kind of literature it is, and spending time and making it interesting. One thing I try to do in one of my classes here is really emphasize that and spend time in these stories in Genesis that are so powerful because it's setting the tone for the wisdom God wants us to walk away with. And it's encouraging to me when I see our guys kind of like, oh, you know, I've never really thought about that way before. Never heard about it. It's like, yeah, it's because we've shaped it, unfortunately, as a, well, here's what God's saying and not saying to you. And so really, and that's the kind of thing where, you know, you go and you read a story, and then you meditate, you think about it. And then you go read another one over here that somebody go back and you're just spending time in it and letting it work on you in a way that you may not know how it's going to happen.
And sometimes part of meditating might be just, it enters the other conversations. I mean, you and I have conversations, you know, you've read some scripture, you've gotten reflected, and we'll get together and we'll get kind of talking about it and bouncing ideas off each other. And that's a part of the meditation process.
Absolutely.
That's part of, you know, same thing. I mean, when I have a conversation with somebody and I'm thinking about what they meant, I'll talk to my wife about it and we'll rehearse that conversation as part of my meditation on how am I going to respond, or what's my, you know, my answer to a particular situation or something I'm dealing with. So, you know, that's just a part of the meditation process. And I think it's just integrating all that in my life as a theme. And that scripture kind of then isn't just something in a book.
Right.
It's something that begins to run through my life. It runs through my conversations. It runs through my thought processes. It runs through my choices. It runs through everything and begins to be these little veins that just kind of integrate in my entire life.
Yeah, it's a great point that until quite recently in our, you know, history, we haven't been able to meditate on God's word outside of community. You know, now I can pick up my device and just and I'm riding the bus or whatever and do that. And it's like, and there's value in that. But it's about shared community makes it all the more meaningful, and seeing other perspectives and being challenging to other people. And that's a great part. I know what goes on here is continue to emphasize the community aspect of this. Walked out just a moment ago from class, and you had come in behind one of the guys and said, hey, I want you to look at what you said here on the test. And you didn't see this, but after the next class, he was asking another one of the residents about, and he said, I'm nervous about this. And the other guy and I both said, you don't need to be, don't be worried about it. And he said, I'm going to help you with this, you know, and just having this shared experience makes the word itself more meaningful.
Absolutely.
And that's really good news for us.
Right. You know, you mentioned the community idea. And you know, if you, one of the things that we don't pay a lot of attention to is that in Scripture, most of what it says is that we are to hear the word, listen to
that's
the
right.
word. I mean, the idea was not that we're going to read it to ourselves quietly in reflection. I mean, that's something almost of modern,
very modern
educational kind of thing where you guys sit and you don't want to be talking out loud and disrupting all the people around you. So you have to read it quietly. But back in the day, I mean, people, you know, the scriptures were being read aloud to people. There weren't that many people who were illiterate anyway. And so you're reading aloud and people were listening, hearing the word, right? And then that became the thing that they would then ruminate about and meditate
right,
on
right.
And that type of thing. And so very much that's a part of this process of our relationship.
And then I could say, hey, what do you think David meant there? And then I hear that. And then you're probably opening up into a story in your own life. And then it makes it richer. And I see the connections for other people. And it's not just me out there in a sea of information trying to figure out, you know. Well, and that's another part of this, trying to figure out praying only. So we're going to talk about prayer. And in the context here, it seems like this step is saying, you know, what they focus on is praying only for his will for us and the power to carry that out. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about prayer a little bit.
Well, I mean, I think obviously prayer should be our response to our meditation. Mm. So we have heard God, we've listened to him, we've paid attention to him, which is coming to know his will, right? Which is coming to know who he is and the strength he provides and the values he shares. So all that is part of informing then my prayer that becomes a response to that, in which I'm beseeching God and seeking him out on specific things that concern me, certainly expressing my passion for him and that type of thing. I was going to read, you know, in Psalm 63, I think it's a great passage about this, the passion. And I was reading this the other day. I used it in my Bible study. I just wanted to read it because I think it's so good. It says, Psalm 63, "O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory, because your steadfast love is better than life. My lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied as with fat and rich food, and my mouth will praise you with joyful lips. When I remember you upon my bed and meditate on you in the watches of the night, for you have been my help, and in the shadow of your wings I will sing for joy. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me." You know, that's a prayer.
Mm-hmm.
That's a prayer in response to the meditation of David's heart. And so, you know, it's that, but it's that longing. It's that passion. It's that my soul longs for you. My life is satisfied.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, you see that even in the Beatitudes, right? Hungry and thirsting after righteousness, that satisfaction that comes that begins to then compel the life that we're talking about.
Yeah. And you know, it's one of my favorite Psalms. You know, there's a particular song that goes with comes right to mind for me. And, you know, that phrase, I think it's in verse 3 where he says, "For your love is better than life." And so he's compelled. He's think this is the highest pursuit of my life is to be in a relationship. And this psalm is coming from David's desperate and he's on the run. He's out in the wilderness and it's his refuge is to turn to God and meditate and then respond out of that in prayer. And because, and I guess relating this to the 12 steps, I'm powerless and I am desperate for God. I'm desperate for this entity outside of myself who can change me and make me what I would rather be than what I am today. And so, yeah, being in the terms of relationship where when we're pursuing, we probably all have been in that situation where we're pursuing another person.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the language here we see in Scripture is to really have this relational pursuit.
And it's a prayer and meditation that is well beyond just my litany of requests.
Yeah.
You know, pray for my dog and pray for my grandma and pray for my mommy and daddy. Or my personal things. I mean, so much of prayer is, you know, typically about, you know, my laundry list of things that I'm concerned about because I am not capable of controlling those things.
Is it fair to say that we don't really see that kind of prayer much at all in Scripture?
Right, exactly. And that what you do see is this communion, right? I mean, this prayer that he has request nothing. I mean, other than this expression of my passion for you, my joy for you. Mm. And to go back to what you were very much saying a minute ago, when we pursue a relationship with a person, we love the connectedness of communication, right? We meditate mm-hmm. on what they say. We reflect those things. It's not like, you know, this isn't the grocery list. This You're isn't right. the, you know, can you take out the garbage kind of conversation? This is not that those don't exist, They're but near. This is this bonding in which we're sharing our hearts and our passions and our feelings and our values and our hopes and our dreams and our appreciation for each other and those kind of things. And very much that being the focal point of this meditation and prayer, it's about connecting. Yeah. It's about this conscious contact. It's not about just, you know, kind of, I think what we do a lot of times, I mean, I've thought about this a lot in my own Christian experience because I was raised to, you know, say that you got to have a quiet time every morning. You have to read your Bible for so many minutes and then you're supposed to pray. And then you kind of close up all that up and you kind of go on with your day. Great practice. Mm-hmm. But a lot of times, you know, I thought later on, it's like, basically it was, okay, God's going to talk to you for about 15 minutes. You're going to listen to everything he says, and then you're going to talk to him for another 10 or 15 minutes, and then you'll be done, and then you'll communicate again tomorrow, you know, kind of done with your appointment. And there's nothing bad about any of those things, except it's a very limiting view of what kind of relationship we're really supposed to be having with God.
Yeah, and this idea that prayer, if again, thinking of how we typically have taught it and shaped it, if it and what we hear others do, and we tend to mimic what we, you know, grow up around and hear. When we hear that it's mostly that checklist or litany of items that I'm concerned about, mm-hmm. which again, you know, Paul says, bring everything, anything you're anxious right. about, that right. is certainly a part of it. But if it's only ever that, then I think it seems like I'm going to judge the effectiveness of prayer only by whether or not those things are getting ticked off right. by, right. I don't even know how it would happen, but we assume that this is the way to do it.
Right.
And then maybe that becomes another thing where it's like, this isn't working for me,
right.
you know, or spending time meditating because I'm trying to figure out what this passage says. And I'm somewhere in Judges and I'm reading this story and goes, I don't know what this is saying to me. This right. is no value in right. this. And right. it's almost like because we've focused on very limited ways of interacting with the word
right.
and interacting in prayer, we've made it hard for people to continue in those things right. because we have the wrong expectation coming into it.
Well, and I think it's interesting when people say to me, and they certainly have many times, you know, prayer doesn't work for me.
Right.
Work how?
Work how?
Like,
right.
You know, it's like, it sounds like you just called the cable man and he hadn't shown up.
My campus minister, it really stuck with me. He said, God is not our heavenly bellboy.
Right, right.
And
right.
that is certainly how, hey, ring the right, bell, come right. give me room service
right.
and, you know, take away the trash and whatnot.
Right.
Well, here, I do want to focus a little bit on this because it stuck out to me in this step that I'm praying only for his will. And I think we have a pretty healthy understanding of that. You've already kind of touched on it. But do you think it's fair to say that a lot of people, particularly that are newer in their journey, have an expectation for finding their God's will for them to being something maybe very specific. And if somehow I don't find that and I don't hear the voice of God on that, that I'm missing something. Oh. And that's another way where prayer may be failing me.
Right, right. And yeah, part of not getting what I want, right? And, you know, that's constantly the quest of the people who come into our program. I mean, everybody comes to his way because they want something. And typically it's, I want my mother to be satisfied. I want my wife to let me back in the house. I want the judge to get off my back. I want court cases to disappear. I want to get a job. I want to get back on course with my life. I have no place to live. I want a place to live. I mean, those are the requests that we're coming with as guys walk through this program. But our hope is that when they discover and begin a nurture relationship with God, that all disappears to something much greater. Do all those things need to get resolved and can they get resolved? Absolutely. But that's no longer the passion of why I came here and I begin to discover something. I was in a group last night and it was with one of the guys in the advanced recovery group. So he's getting ready to finish his year here. And he has some court cases on him. In fact, they're still left unresolved at this point. He's been here almost a year. He's on furlough here. And so he's waiting to see what the result of those things are. And it was interesting. It wasn't of no prompting of my own, but, you know, he's talked about kind of where he was in his mindset. He said, you know, at this point, I totally am confident that God's purpose and plan is going to be accomplished here. And if I go back to jail, it's because God's sending me there because he wants me to do something. And I'm fine with that. I'm as good with that as not. You know, I thought, wow, I mean, to say that I'm as comfortable going to jail as not going to jail, because I understand that wherever I am, I'm pursuing the will of God, is a transformative thought.
Yeah. That's and one that would be completely unexpected or even unconscionable to someone who doesn't have that perspective.
Right. And so I think that's what this is about. Yeah. It's about coming into a connectedness with what God's will is. I mean, Jesus' prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane is obviously the obvious place that we can go, because Jesus goes, hey, I don't want to drink this cup.
Yeah.
But, you know, through these series of three prayers, I mean, he comes to, you know, all right, it's time to drink the cup, you know, basically. And so, you know, that's coming to, you know, he said, not my will, but your will be done. And that's a lot of what prayer meditation is about, is coming to, one, be knowledgeable of God's will, and then to come submit my spirit to what that will is going to be, is what really the process is about.
So I want to, you mentioned that. I know that's someone else who's still a resident. One of our staff members, I had a conversation this morning, and who's in the same situation. I actually didn't know it, and I knew he had a lot of legal issues. Said he still has an outstanding court situation, which is going to still take another year or so to even come up. And he doesn't think he's going to go back to jail over it. But he said with his record and the points that accumulate, there's still a really good chance. And he said, you know, I'm at complete peace with that. If that's what happens, I'm not going to be different this time going in. I know who I am. And his transformation has been amazing. Mm-hmm. I just smile thinking about him. I love interacting with him. I did not know that about him. I didn't know that was hanging over his head. But he knows who he is, and he knows what God's will for him is.
Right.
And it's why he's serving, you know, as he is with us today. And it is, it's the thing which says, okay, this guy has found, you know, this true relationship with God that is not connected to his circumstances, just as the guy in ARG is saying. And things that for many of us imagining, you could go to jail still. Oh, wow. That would just, you know, blow me up. And it's like, no, I have a confidence walking with my God that everything's going to be fine.
Right.
And in fact, maybe an opportunity, which is incredible to hear.
Right. Absolutely.
Well, the last part of this is about praying for the power to carry that out. Mm-hmm. I know you have some thoughts from Paul's prayers where he is praying for power.
Right. I mean, you know, if you go back in Ephesians 1, Ephesians 3, and then Colossians 1 as well, Paul has these prayers that he expresses. And it seems like this whole step is formulated in that prayer. I mean, it's so much about the will of God and so much about the strength or power that God can provide to pursue and accomplish those things. You know, even in Philippians, you know, when he says, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength, he's not talking about winning football games. He's talking about being content in whatever circumstance he finds himself, whether in jail, poorly fed, or whether well fed. You know, I'm going to be okay because I'm in the will of God, and I understand that it's his strength that's going to allow me to do it. And I think that's the big challenge with people. We think it's not God's will because it's harder than I want.
Right.
It's more difficult. It requires something more of me than I feel like I have. And one of the things that I tried to tell our guys recently in a class that I was teaching was, why would God, who fundamentally wants to have a personal, intimate relationship with you, provide something for you that causes you not to need him?
Yeah, right. You know,
that's kind of the point, right? So we are going to be called to a will that's beyond our capacity. We are going to be called to a lifestyle that demands his involvement in order for us to fulfill it. If that weren't the case, why would God want to have a relationship with us in the first place? Mm. That's his agenda. And that's our greatest need, is to have a relationship with him, be connected with him. So that ultimately is, you know, the strength is the ability to then do the will when it's beyond my strength. I mean, I had a whole conversation with somebody the other day about, you know, things are not going well and things are difficult. You know, this couldn't be the will of God. Why couldn't it be the will of God? The will of God is that you have an intimate relationship with him. And if you can't do this on your own and you're overwhelmed, God's going, aha, now we're where you need to be, right? So that you can begin to depend upon me and the strength that I provide to become what you can be and to face this situation together, not alone. Not God's going to give you a few things and send you out on a trip. No, he's journeying with you in the trip. He's a part of the trip.
Right.
And that's right. The thing that God wants to do in our lives. And that's what this step is about seeking that kind of connectedness and then that ongoing journey with him.
He just triggered so many different teachings in scripture, but you know, that what God desires is that contrite, that broken heart, because right. That's now when he can work.
Right.
It's that he elevates the humble, but it's mm-hmm. the proud that, you know, that he rejects, or, you know, the rich man. The problem with the rich man is his security is in the riches and, right. you know, he doesn't need anything. It's when we come. And of course, all these steps have been leading, particularly early on, have been recognize our brokenness, recognize our powerlessness. That means by definition, there's a power outside that I'm going to have to rely upon right. and I'm not going to fully understand it.
Right.
And so it's the commitment to the relationship and not always to what the end result's going to be or mm-hmm. the process. I don't know how it's going to go down,
right.
but I'm committed to, because this power, this God is the one who I know I can trust. Because right. I haven't been able to trust myself
right.
if I've come to that honest conclusion.
Right.
And maybe others have let me down. And I know a lot of this is about making peace there and trying to make that better. But we recognize ultimately, if I'm fundamentally flawed as a human and I can't get myself across whatever, you know, goal line that I need, then I probably can't rely upon another person to do that for me either.
Right.
And so yeah, it's going to be something that's difficult. It's something that's outside of us, and yet I can be committed to it still.
Right.
And it's the call for all of us as Christians. And it is unfortunate how we've dumbed down the relational aspect. Kind of as you described earlier, you know, at best, maybe it's the 15 minutes give and take in daily. For many, it's more the once a week at best kind of interaction
right.
in a very, you know, location-based setting. And that's not really much of a relationship. And it's certainly not the kind that will transform us in having those tendrils, as you right. described, going all throughout our lives.
Right.
But what a calling it is. And really the issue is, can we imagine a life without that? And it feels like in Psalm 63, David could not imagine a life without that relationship. It's right. the highest calling. And maybe until we get to that spot, we're going to find every reason to leave when it's hard. And I don't know, that's where the difficulty, I guess, lies, is where our commitment to what God is doing in us versus what's comfortable and what's easy. And when I decide I want to do what I want to do for myself. Right.
I mean, God's ultimate destiny for us is to be in relationship to him. Heaven is about being with him.
That's right.
It's no marriage in heaven because I'm the bride and he's the groom, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what the ultimate destiny is. So why would God's will be anything that doesn't move us toward that, that doesn't help nurture that and train us in that? And so, yeah, everything else will be frustrating because it points us back to the real solution and to the real ultimate mm-hmm. destiny that he has for us. And the more we can grasp that, the more we can enjoy and enjoy the will and enjoy the purpose. Is it going to be easy? No, it's not going to be easy because it's not meant to be easy. It's meant to be our life can only successfully be journeyed with his presence as an ongoing and deepening part of it.
Yeah. And even though it's not easy, you know, it's not without joy,
right? Right,
and it's this whole shift. The same staff member who you know I'm talking about, you know, he said in an interview that we did with him, he said, you know, I'm not always happy, but I always have joy. He's learned the secret of being content. He's learned that there is a deeper part of this walk than just, is my moment right now exactly what I want, what I think I need.
Sure.
It may not be.
Right.
But, you know, what it's achieving for me
right.
far outweighs anything that's light and momentary. And of course, when Paul says that, he's going through shipwrecks and imprisonment and things that are really hard to imagine. And I think most of our things really are light and momentary. And yet we've convinced ourselves that we've got to run from those and define, you know, the easiest way out that we can,
right.
which is, you know, that's the struggle of humanity. Me wanting to rule my life instead of letting God rule my life.
Right.
Well, we have one more to go.
Yep. Step 12.
It's been a journey. And I guess that's the words we use here all the time. So thanks for sitting down again. And I know we're going to transition here soon to some other things, but probably still riffing off of these 12 steps and maybe seeing how that plays out and some actual guys that have walked through this recently. And I'm looking forward to that.
That'd be great.
All right. Well, thank you for joining us here today. And if you have any questions about our program, we'd like you to visit our website at hiswayinc.org.